Hello there, GM Lurch Lurchington here. Welcome to the first episode of Star Wars Showdown on Iceball Station. With us today are our players and their characters. Bendu as Narset Jin.
Hello there.
Dan as Warm of Ithor.
Hey.
David as Zavik Silverstar.
Here's.
And our host Kyle as Zeef.
Hello there.
Players, if you're ready to roll Destiny, let's see if the Force is with us tonight. One dark side to start. Two lights and a dark. Okay, so we've got four lights and two darks. Pretty good stuff. Force is with you. All right, so we're going to start our story like many a Star Wars starts in a spaceship. That spaceship, in this case, is the Lady Luck, who's plying her way down the hyperlanes towards Hutt space. While Lando Calrissian is, as usual, at the helm, he's got some Jedi passengers that he picked up on Yavin. With him on this journey is Master Zavik Silverstar. Master Silverstar has been accompanying Calrissian in the cockpit for most of the journey. Their other passenger, Knight Narset Jin, has been secluded back in the ship. For weeks now, Narset has been plagued by strange dreams, Force premonitions that she's untangled over time. Once the dreams became clear enough to her that she felt comfortable in bringing them to the Masters, she did. And because of the specifics of those dreams, which we'll go over in a bit, once Miss Jin wakes, as soon as you wake up, they're going to ask you about those dreams and you're going to roll, and I might give you more detail than you had before, depending on that roll. But you'll still get a rundown of all of them. But the contents of those dreams has caused you and Miss Jin to get transport from Lando out to planet Iceball, which we will be arriving at shortly. The reversion from hyperspace is imminent, and as these things happen to happen in Star Wars, just before this reversion from hyperspace, Narset is running through her dreams one more time back in one of the passenger cabins of the Lady Luck. It is seven images in one force dream. Yes, over time, more of the dream revealed itself to you in this sequence. The first image that you were able to discern was an icy, frozen blue and white planet in the void. Could have been one of any. The second image from this planet, a volcanic island in the middle of a frozen sea surrounded by other icy islands. The vision progressed and moved in. The third image was of a factory at the rim of this volcano. Massive towers set up around the rim of the volcano. Whether they're a field generator or some sort of collectors, you couldn't tell, but a big factory complex clinging to the side of the volcano with these devices set up around the rim of the volcano on this island. And then, as the vision progressed, a city at the edge of the bay of this island and streams of workers moving up and down the side of the volcano to the factory. Finally, coming out of the city, not following the workers, heading out, as your vision pushes in on the island, you see a speeder racing out of the city. And in that speeder, an Ithorian and a Gungan, desperately fleeing this city. Finally, the vision pulls back to encompass the entire island and its volcano and the city and the workers and the factory and the Ithorian and the Gungan fleeing out of the city and pushes in again on the volcano. And the final image of this vision was one of the Jedi Masters of Praxia, Zavik Silverstar, standing on a metallic platform inside this volcano, next to you, both of you with your lightsabers lit. Once all of these images had resolved themselves to you, you resolved yourself to inform Master Silverstar, who was present on Yavin at the time, and you two did some research. After describing the planet you saw to other masters, doing some research on the Holonet, finally it was Lando Calrissian who was dropping off some supply, who recognized some details from your dream and said, "Oh, I've been to that planet before. It's a real ice ball. But if that's where you want to go, I can take you. You set off from Yavin 2 days ago, and you've been trying to get more from these dreams on the journey. Now awakening from this latest dream, you can feel Master Silverstar and Calrissian at the front of the ship. Behind you, you hear the quiet thrum of the Lady Luck's engines. You can sense in your mind hyperspace around you, and you know that your destination is close.
So Narset wakes up, and then as I run toward the cockpit, kind of double-checking with Master Zavix where exactly our destination is.
Absolutely.
So I leave the room that I'm in, thinking about...
And head towards the front of the ship.
Yeah, thinking about, like, what was the time frame of this vision? Like, are we supposed to do this one thing at a time? So now I'm running to the cockpit to see, like, hey, I just saw a bunch of ice stuff originally, and I just saw a bunch of ice stuff now, but now I just saw a volcano. Where exactly are
okay,
we going?
Okay, so again? If you want to get more juice out of the dream, you can make a lore check to try to get more wisdom from the Force.
Do it.
All right. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Two yellows and a green diamond. Let's
all right. Making a lore check. You do not. You failed with two threat. Yes.
You know what that means? Is that it's very Force. The Force is very specifically saying that as soon as you need to get to this location, we're not going to tell you shit until you get to this location and figure out why you're needing to be at this location.
It seems like those two gentlemen in the dream...
It's a fucking tarot card answer.
Yeah. The two alien gentlemen in your dream seemed like they were in a hurry. But that was the only part of the dream that seemed rushed. And I'm just going to use those two threat later on to add a black die. So, Master Silverstar, you and Calrissian, he's giving you guys a lift to this ice ball. And he, as you burst in, is telling Zavix what he knows about this ice ball. He has been telling you, I'm not going to try to Lando Calrissian. Yeah. No. He has been relating to you that he did stop by here once, and this was decades ago, before the war ended. At the time, because there's a nice little casino and bar on the planet. Most of it is a frozen hutscape, but outside of the main city, there's a nice little fishing town, and there is a beautiful casino there. It's like somebody took a little piece of Canto Bite and put it on the side of a glacier. Beautiful views of the bay, lovely people, wonderful droids.
Show up, be like, bro, we don't fucking care about the casino.
Why am I doing this for Lando again?
He's giving you guys the ride because he knew about the place. Gotcha. No one you told about this ice ball knew it. And he was like, Volcano Factory. Yeah. And he sort of pried in and some more details you would have gotten out of the vision if you'd rolled better correspond with some of the things he knows about the planet. So, you know, you didn't do well on the roll and hear about the casino. But at one point, you remembered a casino, and he's like, yeah, I know the casino on that ice planet. Lando knows
my
the
mouth
planet.
Shut.
And he's saying, yeah, it was lovely then, but I hear it's really gone to pot. But it does have a landing field, so once we get out of hyperspace, we'll see where you guys want to put down. He looks at both of you, Narset in her Jedi robes, and you in, like, you're wearing heavy clothing, so you've got like some adventurous tech clothing, but neither of what you're wearing has any kind of environmental rating. Calrissian says both of you look like you're kind of underdressed, but you know, you're Jedi, so maybe, you know, you just don't mind. And then once Narset takes a seat, he sets about getting ready to revert from hyperspace so that you guys can talk and I can shut up for a minute. Zavix.
As we power Narset down from hyperspace calming down. So, Lando, do you have any contacts I might want to get in touch with there?
Like I said, it's been more than 20 years since I was there last, but the bar is the kind of, the casino is the kind of organization, the kind of operation that doesn't seem like it changes hands. So I would start there. They were good people. Weird for hut space, but they certainly kept the swank of the core and the colonies going out there in the rim. He looks at both of you and he says, you two should fit right in. Keep those hidden. And he indicates your lightsabers. But other than that, you should have no trouble finding a room and getting help If you ask around the club, it's full of old adventurers and stuff like that. Scoundrels. I don't know who would be there now, but yeah.
Arsa, you seem it's troubled like gentlemen after you came adventurers. Out of the back there. Did you see anything new?
No, I just sensed that we were close to our destination. I wanted to check in as to where on the planet we were exactly landing or heading towards, if there was a particular reason why we were heading to this direction towards this casino for a reason. But so, finding out that it's purely because of Lando's familiarity. If there's
coincidentally, he knew the place.
If this casino, I'm sure we could find a factory worker or someone who might have a similar idea. Because the image of having this volcano on an ice planet, somebody has to know where this volcano is. So if we go to this highly populated casino, there is potential that somebody will know what it is. And if we make ourselves look like tourists, more of a chance that someone will guess where it is if we look like a tourist versus Jedi.
I think that's a great place to start.
So all of this is the information that, and Lando confirmed. He's like, yeah, I was there 20 years ago at the casino in Fishtown. It was lovely. The factory workers, they're working for the Hutts and it sucks, but like they had a real nice vibe going at the casino. I stayed there for a while. There's a lot of gentleman adventurer types out there, sort of core worlders and guys from the colonies who want to go and rough it while still not like having like a nice core world and colony place to come back to, kind of thing. If you want to go hunt on Tatooine but aren't going to stay on Tatooine, you can stay here and then travel to Tatooine, kind of thing. So he reverts from hyperspace and the icy blue-white planet from your visions resolves itself in the middle of the starfield.
Maybe I can do a lore check myself, see if I can understand anything else what's going on.
Yeah, I want you guys to make checks now because we're going to transition away from you and to the other two characters at this point.
I'm going to go ahead and do a check real quick.
Okay, excellent. Give me a hard lore check. You can take a blue boost die because Calrissian has given you guys extra info. You can just roll it afterwards. All right, so you did not succeed.
Your vision is clouded.
Yeah, the Force is not with you guys. Both Jedi...
It's troubling to hear.
...would take rain, but they're going to have ample time to rest before they land, so...
What about if I asked Lando about ways that I can make money on this ice ball? Would he happen to know a few ways to do that? Because it seems like I'm going to need to get gear and stuff for the rest of this trip. It's going to be a long trip in there. I feel like I'm going to need to get settled. Says, in some.
Well,
that is one question. If I do happen, and I do want that Jedi utility.
When you mentioned making money, he smiled and he looks at you slyly and he says, "There are plenty of ways to make money on Ice Ball. Tell me, what are you best at? Sabacc, Pazak." He names many other Star Wars.
I was gonna say
not really like, much for games.
Gambling games. He goes. I have directed you to a casino.
Is that what Michael dropped off as a headset?
No, it was my brother-in-law. He gave me.
It's a growler.
Of homebrewed ale.
Hell yeah!
Good times.
Lando is telling us how to.
Lando says if you want to make money,
gamble.
Make money hand over fist at the casino. He said otherwise, most of the money on the planet is in the hands of the Hutts. They squeeze it out of the volcano with the workers, and then it goes into their coffers on Nal Hutta. They've even managed to edge the mining guild out of their operation.
Oh, man.
They set up the factory, but the Hutts are completely running things been for a century and a half at this point. He says the planet is in Hutt space, after all. It's not like anyone has had jurisdiction other than themselves.
Right. Yeah, that sounds like Hutt space. It's pretty much self-policing because no one's willing to spend the resources to move in and control it. So.
Yeah. All right, so down on planet Iceball, as the camera focuses on the planet approaching through the view screen and then pushes in, we transition to a back alley. In the docks of the worker city on the bay at the foot of the volcano. Zeef, a Gungan, is creeping on an alley between two warehouses. He has been on the trail of some new strong and dangerous substances that have recently been introduced into what has otherwise been a fairly well-controlled drug scene on Iceball. The Putts don't mind if their workers juice themselves up during the day. They don't mind if they knock themselves out at night. They don't want anyone killing themselves.
There's no profit in that.
When a foreman at one of the warehouses wound up dead, people really took notice. Zeef shook down a dealer he already knew, who said, it's not him, he's not stupid, he's not trying to end up legless in the bay. But he's heard that there are some new guys moving merch in the city. Zeef has followed one of them back to a warehouse down by the docks, and he is now creeping around the outside of it, like a sneaky, sneaky Gungan. He left his friend and driver, Warum, in their speeder idling around a corner a block away. Stomper had already been sent down the docks 15 minutes earlier and had said that he had located the spot, and that is the building that Zeef is now creeping around the outside of.
All right. I'm just investigating right now. Do I hear anything of note? I guess I want to inspect my surroundings, inspect the outside of this building for any signs of activity.
So you're going to use a perception or a streetwise check. So give me skullduggery or perception.
Misa going to use my skullduggery.
Okay, so your skullduggery is 3 green dice. The difficulty is 2 purples plus a black because of the frigid cold ever present on Iceball, and another black die because you are in a dark alley. A failure with 2 advantages. You don't hear anything, but you see an open window in the side of the warehouse.
I'm going to spend a maneuver to try and get myself up there so I can peek through if it's not too high up on the building.
There is a plentiful detritus in this alleyway, and you are very capable of making your way up to the window. Inside, you see that the warehouse appears full at the front, but you have an angle to the middle of the warehouse where you see a space has been cleared, and there are a couple of tables set up and equipment on the tables. There are a couple of Quarren working, doing some sort of, chemistry work at the table, and there are some other figures moving around the edges of the room, but you don't have a good view of them through the window. But it looks like you've found a drug lab.
Yeah, Misa thinking something smells stinkowiff, but I'm not sure what I'm going to do yet.
So there's a huge door at the front of this warehouse, and then there are some side entrances.
If I was to go through this window and enter that way, what's on the other side of this, like directly below me? Can I jump down safely and still be obscured from these people in the warehouse, or would they see me straight away?
There are boxes in the way, but you would have to make a check to get through, like, quietly, without gunganing it up, certainly. I want some coordination.
Coordination? Okay, that's 3 greens.
That's a challenge.
Hey, I'm a Gungan. That means I'm naturally coordinated as fuck.
That's right. Because when I think Gungan, I think coordination.
Absolutely.
It's only Jar Jar that's a fuck up, honestly.
Playing with my maps.
And Jar Jar's not even really a fuck up. I mean, he's the ultimate example of failing upward.
He didn't even want it, though. He's like, a general? Don't you know me? Like,
right.
Even in the battle, though, I don't know. I think it's hilarious that he was going to be Meeber Gascon instead. And I was like, how would they have done that?
What evidence do I have that this is a drug operation? Am I seeing drugs on that table?
You see that they've got a drug set up. You followed one of the dealers.
Gotcha.
Like, it's going on. Well, the guy he shook down, the first guy he questioned was his dealer and was like, you guys are selling, like, your stim now? And he was like, no, we're not. But there are new guys. And his own dealer did point him to the guys who he followed here, yes. Because Zeef did start with drugs in his inventory.
Here's the facts. So. We've got a foreman of this warehouse who is OD'd on raw, unprocessed spice, which is not only illegal, it's not obtainable. Well, not this warehouse, but the foreman of a warehouse was found dead OD'd on raw unprocessed spice, which is not only illegal, but it's not generally obtainable here, which is what really spurred the investigation on. Where's it coming from?
All right, so you are at a window, which is in the wall, about where you are. You were able to see through that gap in the crates to this stuff. You can see that there are other guys moving around in there, but you didn't get a good bead on them. There's a second floor that you can see up there. You don't have a good view of the entire interior of this place outside where you are.
Gotcha.
Right now.
And you then said Warham the door is on the north. Car.
No, the main door is on the south end of the building right next to Stomper.
It's like a big garage door, I think.
And Stomper has entered the building. He's inside the building.
Stomper is inside the building. Yes. Stomper is.
That's the awesome thing about having a Gonk droid companion is that he blends in, no one ever notices him.
Can go anywhere.
Yep. He's like Marcus Brody. He'll blend in, disappear. No one will ever see him again.
Does anyone speak Gonk?
You guys are here now.
I'm going to use my little wrist comlink to send Stomper in through those north doors and have him create some sort of a commotion, distracting people, leading them towards that northwest corner so that I can slip in the east side door here.
All right, so Stomper makes his way to the back of the building along that far west wall until he reaches the northwest corner, and he is going to attempt to knock over this stack of crates.
You could do it, buddy.
He's got a setback because he only has one tiny manipulator arm to like fix to it. And he needs to get one of the upper crates, obviously, because he would not be able to shift a lower one with that one little manipulator. He fails. He struggles against the crates.
No.
And lets out a pessimistic gong through the communicator. And then decides to
stubby little body against it.
Be more practical and starts gonking his way west along the north end of the. And he's just going to now, as plan B, unless you stop him, he's going to waddle just into view of all of them and distract them the practical way, having failed to move these boxes. So he just gonks right out there. Into view of everybody and has at least distracted them visually for a moment.
Fair play to him.
As a wild gonk droid stomps across the open area into a different pile of crates along the west wall. So now's the time to either via coordination or stealth make your way.
I'm going to use stealth because I have a yellow.
Yes.
Yellow, excellent. green for stealth.
It will be an average difficulty check, which is two purples with two setbacks, one for the darkness and one for the cold. You do not succeed, but you have advantage, so you scramble up there and pull the window the rest of the way open. For dropping down. In that time, one of the guards has approached Stomper and is shooing him back towards the front. You can attempt again with a boost die from your advantages.
Okay. Yeah, I'll do it. I'll spend a boost.
All right, excellent. This time you succeed advantageously of now scrambling in through the window and behind these crates. To your left, along the east wall, you see stairs up to the second floor offices at the north end of the building. In front of you, you see the open area in the middle of the building where some Quarrens are working at two tables. Now that you're closer, you can see that some pretty buff-looking Aquavesh are keeping an eye on the area, one of which is shooing Stomper through the crates and towards the front and now turning back around. But you have managed to get behind these crates and into the building.
I'm going to use my wrist communicator
successfully.
To tell him to just continue being a distraction there while I make my way slowly towards those stairs.
All right. Excellent. Stomper doesn't go out the door, and the Aquash is forced to head towards the front and corral him out manually.
Good boy,
Stomper. The front door to the warehouse open as part of the necessity of him doing this. And you're able to make your way to the bottom of the stairs with no problem. You're going to need another stealth check to get up to these offices.
Alrighty, let's do it. YGG. Right.
Yep.
Misa going to get to the bottom of this. Okie day.
Alright. It is still an average difficulty check with a setback because it's still pretty cold in here. They don't have the heaters or anything on. Just
are the stairs lighting. Are the stairs lit, or is this still a dark section of the warehouse?
So the lights are only half on, and the heaters aren't on. They're not trying to have it look like anybody's in here.
It's low budget. It's like a swinging light bulb situation.
Exactly.
Gotcha.
Yep. So there's a setback from the difficulty getting up the stairs, but a boost to your stealth as well from the fact that it's dark in here, but it's also dark for you to deal with.
Right.
So triumphantly and successfully. So you got a success, which is a triumph, and three advantages on that roll. So you make your way up to the top of the stairs where there is a door. Into the offices here, and you rolled a triumph. So you tell me, and I won't tell you, what that triumph means.
I would want that triumph to be that as I approach the offices at the top of the stairs, I hear just the right snippet of conversation that I need to confirm my suspicions about these drugs.
Okay, so you hear an Aqualish voice saying,
"Yeah, absolutely, boss. No, it seems like the operation is working. None of the huts here are offering anything with the kick of what we've got. So I think as long as we keep below the radar, we'll be able to do good business. Of course, if they come down, they'll come down hard."
That's all Misa needed to hear.
All right. So you've got three advantages, which would allow you to make another maneuver if you want. You can get back down these stairs or through the door or, you know, along the catwalk from here.
And how many are all? There's three offices up there, right?
There should be. There's at least two.
Yeah. Okay, are they both occupied, or can I go into the unoccupied one?
You can certainly slip into the next office.
Cool.
All right. This is a largely empty room, owing to the fact that this is a, like, clandestine operation. They have a couple of crates stuffed in a corner. The desk is pushed against a wall, pinning the chair. There is a hookup for computer terminals, but there's no system installed.
Gotcha.
At present, through the wall, you can hear...
I was going to say, can I cut my hair to the wall and just, like, do that one?
There is a very deep but indistinct voice responding to him very shortly and curtly. And then the Aqualesh is in sort of an appeasing manner saying,
"Oh yeah, absolutely, boss. No, if you guys want to come check things out, I'm pretty sure we can get things set up that if you guys, you know, come through in a week or two, everything should be fine then. You know, give us some time to make sure that, you know, nobody's sniffing around. Certainly. But I think everything will be set up just fine, you know. There's no need for you guys to come down here though. Honestly. I think everything's working just great."
And there's another response, and he goes,
"I mean, whatever you say, you know, you're the boss, boss. We'll be ready for you, certainly. You know, thanks for letting us know, though."
Then you hear a creak of a chair, of somebody sitting down heavily.
Okay, it sounds like this is telling me that there's only one person in that room, and that he was speaking to a hologram transmission. I want to burst into the room and grab this dude before he has a chance to touch a comlink or anything.
If you want to make another check to try to get the bum's rush on this guy, you can, but it will be a initiative roll as you come in through the door.
Gotcha. Okay. Because
it's going to be a fight. Cool.
I'm going to let Warham know non-verbally, just like press a little button so he gets a little red flashing light on his dashboard, just to let him know that
it's the flashing light that means action.
Action time. Yeah. Just be ready. Be ready, partner. It's action time. And then I will use... What kind of check should I use to bust down that door? Because I'm trying to, like, fling the door open and just tackle him straight
away.
So
if you are ambushing him, which means you get to use your cool or your vigilance, and you roll it against nothing to generate successes to...
I have a yellow in vigilance, order. So I'm going to go with that.
You got three successes and three advantages, which is generating the initiative order, which is a good number. You'll probably go before this guy. The mobster is purples. Well, he's just a local guy who's running this, you know?
So sure, greens. Sure.
All right. And he got three advantages. So he'll go after you because three successes and three advantages beats three advantages by... three successes. So you do go first. If you want to dive across the desk and, like, engage him, that's a brawl attack.
That's exactly what I want to do. And I have an athletics advantage for being a Gungan, too. So I should be able to sail across that room.
Three successes and one threat. You take a strain because you catch your knee on the desk, but you hit him with a flying tackle. Are you using the sap glove as part of this tackle?
I have the sap gloves in, equipped. Yeah, I'm not really punching with them, but I'm grabbing him and like pinning him to the ground.
So you're grappling him. I'm just wondering if you're trying to do damage.
Not really. I'm trying. The end game here is I tackle him, flip him over, throw my nice binder cuffs on him, and then I sort of grab him by the shoulders and like, we're gonna have a nice little talk, okie day.
You have successfully tackled him and pinned him, and taken a strain while you were doing it. You've got him grabbed, but it is his turn, so he is going to attempt to get out of your grapple. If he succeeds, he will not be grappled, and you'll have to grab him again. He fails, though. He fails triumphantly, in that he does not get loose of you, but he kicks an alarm button built into the underside of his desk.
Shit. Damn it.
And says, "Boys, get up here!"
All right, well, time to go loud, I guess. Okay, then I will I will spend a destiny to try and give me the edge in this little athletics check.
He has he is brawlier than you by like he's got 4 brawn and 3 ranks of brawl to your 3 brawn and 2 ranks of brawl.
I have the power of Gungan slapstick, motherfucker.
So you do not succeed, but you get an advantage. So you don't get the puffs on him, but you got him still pinned and the blue die for whatever happens next. His guys are not up the stairs yet. One of the guards is heading that way, and the other one is heading back in from having ousted Stomper. But while the door is closing, Stomper is going to re-enter the building because he is
actually,
loyal.
Before you do that, can I have a...
Yeah, you want to roll some initiative and get in?
Worm has been like a block back with the speeder, right?
Yes.
And I got the indication that to be on the alert. Would I have heard like any of this alarm that was sounded from where I am?
No, this was just like him with a speaker down to his guides.
Okay. I was just wondering, like, if I think if my character heard the alarm, you would have like hopped in the speeder and like headed towards it, but
it's like a foot activated one, so I assume it's like a silent alarm sort of thing.
Yeah. Okay. That's all I had.
But you have been notified by me that stuff's going down.
Yeah, I'm like just waiting in the speeder, like ready, but until I hear from you, I don't think he's actually gonna, you know, if he just thinks that everything is still going to plan until you contact me otherwise, he's just hanging out there with the speeder.
Okay. So yeah, the guards are making their way, but they're not there yet, Zeep, so you've got another chance. This guy's gonna try to get free of you again.
Warham, what are the odds we can try and pull off like a reverse barn swallow? We're like, if we can get those front doors back open, you could drive into the warehouse and I can like throw this guy over the railing into the speeder and like jump in after him and we can like drive back out the way you came.
So what I was actually thinking was if
he fails to get away from you.
Okay. What I was actually thinking was if I had heard the alarm, I would swing around to the front to grab the gonk droid and then maybe like pull around in back of the warehouse and you could like roll him out the window.
Oh, I like that idea too. There's the stairs and their backup are between me and those windows, though. Unless there's upper floor windows from the
offices.
There
are windows. Yeah, there are upper floor windows from.
That's
the office.
That's what I was thinking. Yeah, probably upper floor windows from the office, or we could spend a destiny to create a window.
Put one there. Yeah.
But yeah, as long as you could like keep them out of the office, and subdue the guy, I could just be waiting.
Warm. Go ahead and give me an initiative roll anyway, though.
Okay. 2 and 2.
All right. You guys go before any of them.
Hey, Warham, come in. This is Zeef. We're going to be coming out hot here in a minute.
I'm away.
Cool. All
right.
I'm going to spend a maneuver, try and get those cuffs on him.
Cool. All right, your action one last time. This guy's pretty beaten up. It's going to be significantly easier than it's been previously. Successfully, but with threat, you take another 2 strain. You slap the cuffs on this guy. Just as you hear his guards coming up the stairs outside. Warham, I assume that you're piloting?
Yeah, so I'm in the speeder.
Your way over? Alright, so this round you are up here. If you're heading towards the front or the back, you will appear with the speeder on map. Have spawned at the front of the warehouse.
Okay, and I see Stomper, like, just waddling around.
Yeah, he's trying to front. Make his way back in inside. Yep.
So I just kind of lean over and haul him into the back seat of the speeder.
Nice.
I don't know. Do I have to check, make a check for that, or is that?
He is.
I mean, he wouldn't be resisting or anything, I assume.
No, he's. If you're
he's
helping
a,
him,
he's a big droid,
up.
So I mean,
yeah.
I don't know.
With your help, he can scramble
okay.
onto the thing. He couldn't make it up on there without somebody trying to help him.
All right, and then yeah. So then I'm just gonna come over to Zeef. Hey, Zeef, I got Stomper. Where you at?
I'm on the east side of the building, upstairs in the offices. Park, like try and park, hover under the middle window.
Gotcha. All right, and then with my second maneuver, Worm's gonna pilot around to the back of the
cool.
building. Be waiting right there.
Perfect. I've got this guy in cuffs.
You don't care enough about this vehicle to have to make a check to drive through an alley in it. The guards are going to go before we get back up to
the
top of the round.
That's right.
He is using his maneuver to come in through the already open door. It is an Aquarush. He has a blaster pistol in his hand, and he is going to make an unaimed shot at you, Zeef, because he comes in and he sees you standing behind the boss's desk after the boss called for help. Thug shoots at Zeef.
Come on, come on.
And he hits three successes.
Oh, no.
Wait, Zeef shot or
he takes a wound.
He was shot at.
Zeef was shot at.
Oh, shit. But it wasn't a hit?
It was a hit.
Oh, it was a hit.
Three
yeah, that's
successes.
What I thought.
Yep. It was three successes. The guy takes a point of strain from the threat, but you were hit for 9 damage.
Oof.
His 6 damage blaster pistol with 3 extra successes sear into you for 9 points of damage. Your armor soaks 5 of them, and you take 4 wounds towards your threshold of 15.
Okay, so I'm at 4.
From the blaster shot, the Aqualesh is standing in the doorway. He does not have a second maneuver that he can use for anything. Behind him, you can hear the second Aqualesh at the bottom of the stairs.
I'm not going to waste a maneuver getting my blaster out to return fire, so I'm just going to grab the cuffed dude and try and throw us both out that window, breaking the window
off
as we go through it, landing in the speeder down below.
That is going to be a hard athletics check with a setback from the darkness and the fact that the window is shut and you didn't go over and like. So it is hard and there is a setback. You have 2 yellows and a green. Out the window. Warham, are you going to use a maneuver to like actively try to catch them with the speeder for a boost?
Sure. Yeah, I'll give them a boost.
All right, cool. That's one of the maneuvers on your
I got my head
slot.
Cocked up to the window, and I'm looking out to see
an advantageous failure. You break the window, guy goes out. You don't follow him as you get hung up on the window. You manage to put him through and out the window.
So am I dangling now? Is that what
you are? You are half out this window.
So I think,
and he's
like,
in the snow at the
out.
Back of the place.
Yeah, he fell out the window, but you're like still inside. In
where did he land? Did he land in the speeder?
Next to the speeder.
But in the soft snow, so he's not dead.
No, he takes some damage.
Okay, okay.
He's not dead. He's incapacitated.
Well, sure, and he's yeah, he cuffed too, so he couldn't like break his fall at all.
Fall damage in this system.
The physics engine in this game is merciless. Yeah.
Yeah.
The physics engine is merciless unless you manage to Luke Skywalker your way into like a magic hole. You die from even like a medium distance fall.
Good to know. Good to know.
Okay.
Done.
It's like fucking Conan Exiles.
It's
keep
like
that in
20
mind.
Wounds
yeah.
and 20 strain
game.
Or something. Yeah,
yeah. I want to say it's 10 for a short, then 30 for a medium.
Jesus.
Yeah, and then you can make checks to like reduce
it's like a plus 50 crit for...
They really don't want people to try and jump unless they're a Jedi, huh?
Yeah.
Basically, yeah. Yeah. So they're like, we have jetpacks and magic.
I'll just
so
take the high ground constantly. I'll just
and
right. diving down on people, chopping them in half the entire time.
You're hanging halfway out
oh,
of
Lord.
From the second floor office of a warehouse down by the docks.
Are my arms sitting? Are my arms dangling or are my legs dangling? Which way through the window am I?
Your arms are dangling.
Okay.
You need a man.
So the worst way. The worst way. My ass is exposed to an Oculus with a blaster right now.
Your butt is still in the window or in the room. Yeah, and your arms are out because you just threw the guy out.
Well, this is a fucking success, isn't it?
Right. But you get to go before the mobster.
Okay,
you get
cool.
to go before
no,
the
mobster. No, that was, well, I go before the mobster. Oh, he just went.
That's true. Yeah. I went, which is why I'm hanging through this window right now.
I was trying to be nice, but because Dan has
thanks, partner.
Andy
Thank you.
Style. Right, I was trying to Paul Sheldon this thing and be like, no, Misery wasn't dead. Misery was almost dead, and then the doctor came in, and Paul's like, no, you dirty, or Paul, I've been called, oh, Dan goes, no, you dirty birdie, they were fucked.
Hey, I'm going to try and pull him down.
Oh, okay. So you're going to jump up out of the seat and just grab his arms? And
Can he reach me? I'm like two stories up.
Well, just one story, I think, right?
Well, technically, yes.
On the hood
and I'm going to be standing on the speeder, so, to try and
pull
in.
So go ahead and give me an athletics check.
Oh, God, it's like some Harry Potter bullshit. You're trying to save me from
an average difficulty with one setback because you're standing on a bobbing speeder.
Okay.
It's completely Fast and the Furious.
Hey, Warren, Misa kind of stuck here. Could use some help. This is bad bombing.
Athletics.
Yeah.
You're bad at these physical sorts of things.
I mean, I'm two, which is
average.
I mean,
then again, Zeef is good at them, and that's not been working out in his favor. But you were trying to do difficult stuff. The difficulty of cuffing and punching that guy was hard.
I was punching above my weight there, so I'm not surprised that I'm hanging out a window right now.
The campaign is take on, like, a sub-boss as a solo. Yeah, you know? Like,
Zeef doesn't fuck around. He's on the case.
No, I get it. You guys had a heroic start, too, so, like, I don't feel bad that they're a rival.
And I'm going to spend a destiny also to try and
absolutely
upgrade one of these.
Give yourself a
boost. So you said purple setback?
Purple setback, yes, sir.
All right. Can I get a boost from him reaching towards me or something?
I'm flopping like a fish right now to try and wiggle through.
For the he already used both maneuvers for the round, so he cannot provide an assist.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm gonna get all gamey about it.
No, it's fine. Alright.
The window pane's starting to dig into my stomach, you guys. This kinda hurts.
Failure. One advantage, and you can hand him a boost to scramble out of there.
Yes, yes. Take this boost, please.
The Aqualad.
Yeah, I will give him a boost.
Runs over and grabs you.
Please be gentle.
He's gonna try to haul you back in. So,
no!
Warham, I'm gonna say that you're now gonna tug of Zeef with this Aqualad. So his brawn is 3.
It's funny, he's an Aqualish and his face looks like a butt, and my butt is in his face right now.
Ah!
Just wanted to point out that cinematic parallel.
It's like
just be careful they don't saw you in half.
On that, right, on like the
broken glass of the window pane, yeah. Yeesh.
So your athletics to purple.
I am wearing heavy, a pretty thick environmental garb, so they do have some protection from the glass, probably.
Yeah.
Yeah, you got armor, so.
He fails with a threat to get Zeef out of your grip.
I farted
so
in his face.
I'm going to say that at which point do you let go.
Exactly.
He lets go recoiling and you end up on top of Warham. In the pilot seat of your speeder.
Another happy landing.
Do you still have to get this guy out of the snow, though?
Yes.
All right, well, we're back at the top because the guards went and failed. So you guys get to act before they can.
I'm going to take
guy ran up.
Why don't you go first, Zeef, to try and get this guy in here, and then I will get back. And then if you do, then
he can use his round to do that, and it doesn't take a check to haul this guy up onto the back of the speeder.
Can I use
of where Stomper is?
A second maneuver to engage a stim pack to try and recover some of that health from the blaster shot.
Absolutely.
Cool.
Yes, you stim yourself, and it heals you for 5 wounds.
There we go.
It is your first. The way stim packs work is that they work in a decreasing amount of effectiveness across the day. Build your first impact of the day sense. Heals you for 5, then 4, 3, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1.
I actually took Medic as a second spec, so I actually have the first rank of that.
Cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
So he's already got plus 1 to stimming.
Sweet. You can get my next one.
Yeah, so that
because God knows we're going to need it.
That was all of the wounds you took.
Yeah, that was all everything you had, so it wasn't
cool. Heal you for, yeah,
but
everything you had. You're back down to 0 wounds. And, Warham, everyone is in.
Then I am going to drive us back. I'm assuming that we're going to take kind of like a circuitous route to throw off any...
you guys are in the docks, which are at the south end of the city along the bay. You are at the western end of the docks, closest to the gas works and then eventually Fishtown. Sort of the edge of the docks and the city. You have followed this case all the way out of Fishtown into the edge of the city, which is quite bold of these criminals to be operating right at the edge of this cartel-controlled city instead of Fishtown itself. And that is because as you make your way out of the docks and towards the lone highway that leads from the city to the gasworks and eventually Fishtown, an AA-5 heavy speeder truck careens around a corner. There are a couple of Aqualash behind the wheel and in the passenger. One of them is shaking what looks like an ion spear at you. Not the most effective weapon to use in vehicle-to-vehicle combat. But the truck is taking off right after you, and all of this is so that you are chased from the docks along the highway in your speeder, exactly matching the vision of Narset Jin. And the camera, in fact, leaves you guys as you escape the docks with this truck behind you. And we return our point of view to the Lady Luck, which is now descended to the planet and is making its way across the bay where Lando is talking to you, Masters Jedi, about your options to land. He says there's a landing platform, a big one up there on the ridge, that transports come in to take off the Clauzon 36 that they process up at the factory. There are some small landing platforms up at the factory for shuttles and such, but a pilot like Lando Calrissian can squeeze his ship into any sort of space and could drop you off basically anywhere. Fishtown has a landing platform at the casino, which was what he recommended. And there's landing at the gas works and probably places to land. He could basically drop you off anywhere on that you wanted. As you approach across the bay, however, Narset, your gaze is drawn out the window towards a tiny light in the distance, a pair of lights racing along a darkened highway from the city out towards Fishtown.
Okay.
Calrissian notices your attention and toggles a command on Lady Luck's dashboard, and the view screen zooms in on the quadrant that you're looking at, providing you a much closer observation of the lights, which is a blue speeder being followed by a truck racing along the highway. It's lost.
Like trouble.
And then the camera catches up again, and you see the Ithorian and the Gungan from your vision in this speeder chase, racing towards Fishtown, having just made their way through the roads around the gasworks. The truck that was chasing them stays behind at the gasworks.
So we
after
can't
it slams
see,
into.
We can't see what's chasing them yet.
There was a truck. It was chasing them, but they lost it at the gasworks, and now they're running towards Fishtown.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah, you've described your dream enough time to others that the fact that I just told you that these are the figures from your dream, Zavix would be aware of that as well. And you can see them, like, a live view of them. As alive as... A live view of them is alive... You know, and as real as if they were 20 meters in front of the ship, you know, through the magnified viewport in their speeder.
It appears time is on our side. We were meant to get here at this moment.
They're heading towards Fishtown, and the landing field at the Expat Club is the only sizable landing in Fishtown. But Calrissian could drop you guys off at the docks.
The drop off would be easiest wherever's closest to the speeder.
Well, they'll be coming in from the edge of town, and neither of sort of the places he could leave you guys are, you know, right there.
The speeder would be freaked the fuck out if all of a sudden just some random ship drops right on them, and then like
a small yacht,
luxury yacht,
the sky
just drops out of the sky on top of it.
Yeah.
I mean, I would assume that that's reinforcements coming to finish us off.
Exactly. Yeah, which is not the impression.
Best introduction.
Calrissian can drop you guys either at the Expat Club or the docks or just like the edge of town. He can't really put it down, like, on Main Street. I mean, maybe if you asked real nicely, but...
Yeah, I don't know, like, wherever...
Certainly could.
Most easiest.
Lando's not gonna... I'm still more so surprised...
Have they noticed us?
I'm surprised that Zavix even agreed to follow me on this mission. Like, we don't even know what exactly these visions are even pointing us towards, and yet we're just kind of out here going, just following it.
Just going for it.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Almost as the Force wills it.
It's true. But still, yeah, no, respect for coming out on this mission just because, Master Zavix. But yeah, no, you see exactly what I see. We need to get out there and try to see, like, what's going on with that speeder.
Where do they seem to be headed right now?
They are headed towards Fishtown.
I say we go to Fishtown. If that's where the Force is leading us, why not check it out?
So yeah, to Fishtown, and then we'll do a quick drop off, see if we can see where that speeder went off to and find its drivers.
Yeah, so he can either leave you at the landing field of the casino or down at the docks, and it is up to you guys.
I guess docks?
Let's do the docks coming up to the bar. That would make the most sense for that for a yacht to be parked at.
All right, cool. So Lando slightly changes course and brings you guys into Fishtown. It is a small settlement of about 2,000. At the northwest end of town, there is a compound with a round wall built around it, with a large, glittering, domed building reflecting the last of the setting sun in gold. Around it, there are some townhomes.
Probably looks brilliant on the white snow.
The town disassembles down towards the shore where there are warehouses and docks. A part of the town down by the docks is, instead of being built from the sort of, you know, off-world materials that are brought into Outer Rim worlds, are instead of a more natural construction, about half of the shoreline building. You are dropped at the docks with the, like, standard construction warehouses right near a bar. The Lady Luck descends smoothly on repulsor coil, which cause the skimmers that are parked out on the ice to rock gently. The bay is completely frozen over at this time of year, except for where the waste from the gas work is gushing out into the bay, which is easily keeping that area melted. And also,
nice and toxic.
There is an area of liquid water just around the docks, southern docks of Fishtown. The Crabtown docks still have water around them, but not the Fishtown docks to the right where you're dropped off. Calrissian once more asks if you don't want something heavier to wear before you disembark.
Are you offering?
He says, I have an extensive wardrobe here on Lady Luck. I'm sure I can find something more than appropriate for the both of you.
Yeah.
Certainly more appropriate than what you're already wearing.
Guaranteed it's going to be 10 times more stylish than whatever you got.
I would be much appreciated.
All right. Yeah, so you're both going to get adverse environment gear instead. It is nicely tailored. It's not just some rough jacket with a hood.
Like some overcoat.
Corellian swindler.
And they got to be some flamboyant colors too, because these are Lando's.
This is a nice fur-lined coat.
Some young nerd-lined.
In a deep blue that offsets the light blue and silver of the clothes you're already wearing, Zavix. And for Narset, it is a huge white fur coat with an enormous collar. It's like the one Sean Young is wearing at the end of Blade Runner.
Right,
it's
totally,
really, really big.
Which is almost identical to the coat that Ahsoka wears when she goes with Lux to Mandalore.
He just buries you under.
It's a reference. Yeah. It's a reference to Sean Young's coat, I'm pretty sure.
Well, there we go. We're making the same references. Hey, Dave Filoni, I see you.
I see you, Filoni.
What I'm seeing, right? Yeah. All right, so you're in a Sean Young coat. He has, like, a really nice, with, it's got epaulets.
Can you set a picture of it?
No, because I'm just making it up, but I'll doodle something.
I'll send you a picture of Sean Young's jacket from Blade Runner.
Yeah, but this is, like, a military cut coat of, like, a winter style with, in a deep blue with, golden things on the shoulders, whatever they're called.
My God, epaulets. I forgot how amazingly hideous this coat is. Hang on.
Oh my gosh.
I'm putting in a general chat for you.
Yes.
Yeah, man. Going all out. So those are adverse environment gear. I don't know what the soak is, but it's -1 setback from cold. if you're wearing it. I think they have one soak, maybe. And when you're wearing gear over other gear,
very well.
Yeah. Well, you don't have to take the coat he's offering you, you know. But
oh, I'll definitely take it.
Like, you've got like this waif of a 20-year-old who's already pale.
Are we going into the casino? Oh, we might be going into the casino. So yeah, no, we definitely need...
At this time in the timeline, also, you could potentially sell it as an authentic Calrissian cloak and get some credits, too.
Hold on to this
stuff,
man. I feel
like we shouldn't do that immediately after.
Yeah, this is good.
Not immediately, though.
Pay for your shit.
Thanks. Hey, could you sign this real quick before I leave?
eBay?
No, just for reasons.
Let me eBay your clothes. I'll take it.
Why not? It's a Calrissian, you know?
All right, so you're putting on the coats.
All right, excellent. You are dropped off on the dock, which is floating just above the ice on its own repulsor system. It is late dusk, almost nighttime here on the ice ball. You can hear already the noise of things getting started in the bar closest to the docks. Just across is a larger building that appears still open. It is from the inside through the large windows. You can see that there are numerous stalls set up inside the large market building just across from the bar without even having to go in.